So, before I introduce them, I'd like to just tell you a little story as to how this meeting actually came about and how we discovered these trends. For the last so many years, eYantra has been in existence for 10 years, but for the last 5 years, we've been running an eYantra ideas competition. Whereas the robotics competition trains young engineers in skills, robotic skills, embedded system skills, machine learning, and all these kind of things, we wanted to make these young engineers solve real problems. So we came up with something called an ideas competition where students around these eYantra labs, we were hoping to build an innovation ecosystem around these labs. So we wanted to encourage them to solve real problems. So initially, what we used to do is write us a proposal, look for an interesting problem, give us a proposal to solve it by building a machine. And when your proposals come to us, we will examine them, shortlist them, and some of the nicer proposal, we ask you to actually build the machine that you described under our mentorship. And then we used to have regional finals in Coimbatore, Bombay, Pune, Ahmedabad, Delhi, and all these places, from where we used to get the best ideas to the finals at IIT Bombay. But these were not quite startup grade. They were too wide, they were not focused, and very few of them would actually turn into a startup. So we put our thinking caps on and took the advice of friends, conferred with friends, and we tried an experiment. We asked ourselves the question, could these young engineers, second, third year engineering students, actually solve real problems? Then we thought we'd do an experiment because we can keep on thinking about these things until the very end. So why not try an experiment? We had just established four labs in Bhutan, at the top engineering schools in Bhutan in 2019. So I asked some friends of ours who very graciously accepted our invitation, and we said, let's do a workshop. And what kind of workshop should we do? Because we wanted students to solve real problems. So we asked our Bhutanese friends, Professor Chekki Dorji, who was principal of College of Science and Technology in Bhutan. We asked him, what kind of problems do you have in the country that you'd like your young people to solve? He says, look, disasters. Disasters are a big problem. Every monsoon, we have landslides, roads get washed away, we cannot travel in the country, and stuff like that. Then we have glacial lake overflows, where because of increasing meltwater, the lakes, 2,500 lakes in Bhutan, in the Himalayan region, they could breach their banks and flood the valleys and cause a lot of a disaster. So we said, okay, fine, let's do a disaster management workshop. So we had been referred to Professor Vinod Menon, who is instrumental in having set up the original National Disaster Management Authority in the country. He very graciously accepted. Then we said that we want to have someone who can help us, train the youngsters as to how to think of problems and come up with something which could actually see existence as a startup. So we called Kiran Deshpande, who's a good friend and IIT Bombay alumnus. Then we thought, what is important in disasters? Geographical information systems. So someone who's a senior scientist in the IIT GISE lab, Sumit Sen, we had him join us very graciously. And then we had two others. We had Raghunath Iyer, who you've met already in Atmanirbhar Electronics. And we formed a team and went there. It was a 3-day workshop. And this is a little story of what we did in Bhutan at that time. I'll share with you a few slides to just illustrate the lessons from Bhutan. Let me just show the presentation. Yes. I hope you can see this. Kiran, do you see this?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. So this was lessons from Bhutan on youth and disaster management. I don't have to tell you about eYantra. You know it's funded by MHRD through NMEICT and stuff like that. And it's hosted at IIT Bombay. But we went to discover lessons from Bhutan. And this is the scene that we found, a very interesting scene when we first landed at the College of Science and Technology in Phuntsholing in Bhutan. And we actually have a small video of this, which I'd like to just show you to share with you the atmosphere. We were very impressed by the students we found in Bhutan, who had a very strong national pride. They had this desire to actually, they had this idealism, which really touched us, both in the faculty and the students. And it's very interesting, amongst the highly paid professions. In fact, the most highly paid professions in Bhutan are actually academic, teacher, and health and health worker, right? Doctors and nurses. It's very interesting to see that. Maybe that also explains the motivation levels. So, Deepa, would you play the video?
Oh, sir, it's already playing.
Okay. So this video sets the scene of the Bhutan that we saw at that time, right? Where this was the first day of a semester. All the students are meant to meet in the hall and they have a common prayer, Buddhist chanting and all that. We were really touched by the whole ambience and atmosphere, and we thought it was a very auspicious start to our 3 days our tryst with Bhutan. So we can stop the video. I'll get back to my presentation now.
Yes, sir, you can present, sir.
Okay. So this was the team that went there. On the right, you see Professor Cheki Dorji, who was the director of College of Science and Technology in Phuntsholing in Bhutan, which is the southernmost city, if you like, which is just bordering India. And then we have Sumit Sen on the left. We have Kiran Deshpande here and Vinod Menon. And this was how we held the sessions. These are students. Incidentally, all Bhutanese students in the engineering college have to wear their national dress, which we found very interesting and very endearing. And at the end of the 3 days workshop, we were surprised by the amazing high quality solutions that came up from the students. So we had 5 or 6 students with one faculty. This, for instance, is a team that came up with a wireless underwater pressure sensor, which can relay real-time depth of rivers and lakes to predict floods, right? So at the back, you also see the local Consul General, Ashish Midha, who was from the consulate of the Indian consulate in Phuntsholing. We have a gentleman here who's a mayor of Phuntsholing, and on the right, you have Raghunath Iyer. And this was another team which addressed the problem of traveling on roads in monsoons because you have landslides. So they built a beautiful app, or ideated an app which could do that work. And this is another team which came up with the idea of having a Fitbit sensor on cattle, which can warn you of earthquakes and all sorts of natural disasters. And this was a very interesting time that we had indeed. Right. So this was the session. And right at the end, Ashish Midha came originally thinking that it's a formality. He'll sit there for 10 minutes and go away. But he was there for all of 3 hours to see all the presentations. And he wrote a very interesting dispatch when he went back to work. And apparently when Prime Minister Modi came a few weeks later, he mentioned this activity there. So I'm going to stop this presentation here and come back to our guests who I'd like to introduce. And I'll start with Professor Vinod Menon, who is an alumnus of Kerala University. He was nominated by the PM as founder member of National Disaster Management Authority, where he had the status of Union Minister of State. He's been a chief guest in many international conferences, expert advisory groups, and many consultative committees of various kinds. And he's a consultant to UNICEF, UNDP, and all these agencies. So, Professor Menon, you can take a bow here.
Thank you very much. Great pleasure for me to be here. Thank you.
Okay. Then we have Kiran Deshpande, who is IIT Bombay alumnus. He is co-founder of Mojo Networks, which is a wireless security company. And recently, I'm delighted to say, he has become a member of the executive board of IIT Bombay Alumnus Association. And he's been MD and CEO of Tech Mahindra, and he's taken the company from 7 million to $125 million. So he knows his onions when it comes to doing business. And apart from all these things, he's an angel investor, and he's mentoring lots of startups and things like that. And Kiran, you can take a bow here so they know who you are. Okay. And lastly, here we have Sumit Sen, who got his master's from the UK in and since then he's been working as a certified GIS professional, where he specializes in enterprise computing, geospatial data systems, and these kind of things. And he's a technical evangelist at Genesis International and a senior research scientist at the GISE labs in IIT Bombay. Right, he's also been the co-editor of books on geospatial infrastructure applications and all these kind of things. So here we are, and what we want to do today is that we want to share our experiences, and I want to get their help to understand what we are in for now. Because after this Bhutan experience, we discovered that young people can come up with authentic and genuine and useful solutions to disaster management problems. So we've changed our eYantra ideas competition now into something called an eYantra innovation challenge, which has three stages. In the first stage, with the help of these stalwarts, we wanted to immerse you in what are disasters, what are the ICT tools available for disasters, how do you relate to disasters and stuff like that. And in the stage two, we will kind of take you through a tech sprint. So the first thing is a training sprint. After that, a tech sprint, where you will sprint to actually build a prototype of your solution. And then in the last stage, the best technical proposals we will take right up to startup grade. So this is where Kiran becomes very important, because he and his team will be nurturing you as to how to present your ideas as a business plan and sell it to the world. Because unless it comes out into the world in a feasible way, in a sustainable way, your ideas are not worth very much, right? So having said this, I'd like to first pick on Professor Menon, right, about his disaster management gyan. So first thing I'd like to ask him is that he's used to us dreamers, you know, dreaming about things, let's do this, let's do that, and he's been very collaborative. After your experience, Vinod, what do you feel, can young people actually solve real problems in disaster management, right? From your experience in Bhutan and what you've seen since about eYantra.
Right. I think, Professor Kaviarya, this is actually an opportunity for us to come together. Young people are also extremely proactive, and then they also have a lot of opportunity to interact with the world of knowledge. And infodemic is now happening because of the current experience in the COVID thing. We have a large access to a lot of knowledge, and disaster management has become very multidisciplinary. And so I feel that the young engineers will be able to come up with technological solutions to help us strengthen our own early warning systems, predicting in terms of, you know, how disasters happen. So we will actually be looking at the knowledge, you know, which the young people come up with. They're very creative, so look forward to that.
So one thing I'd like to ask you, why don't these creative disaster management ideas actually exist there? And why are they not deployed already? Like, for instance, I want to ask you one thing. What is the cost, the national cost of disasters? Can you give us a feel for that?
See, actually, for the whole country, for a period of 5 years, the 15th Finance Commission has put it at about 100,000 crores. That is the money which is earmarked for disaster management, for the 5 years. But normally what happens is that one mega disaster actually can take away, 30 to 40,000 crores. So this is something where, we feel that, for the whole country for 5 years, this amount is not sufficient. So we need to really invest in disaster preparedness, early warning systems, and creating capacities for the communities and multiple stakeholder groups. So corporates can come in, startup companies can come in, and then look at a lot more solutions in looking at sensors, looking at AI algorithms and robotics, and many, many, many components, including machine learning, deep learning, big data analytics. So these are solutions possible.
Oh, thanks, Vinod. Kiran, I'd like to jump to you here. You're a corporate guy, okay? Why aren't corporates like Tech Mahindra, TCS, Cognizant, and all these guys building cool disaster management solutions or systems that can address? You have to turn your camera a bit higher, otherwise we are...
Okay.
So why aren't these big shot companies, right, who you represent, not doing something cool about disaster management and seeing all our national resources going to waste like that?
Kavi, can you hear me? I just want to make sure.
Yes, that... yes, yes.
Actually, you know, as entrepreneur, I'm happy that they are not doing, because then that gives us the opportunity for entrepreneurs to build something. Having said that, on a lighter note, as Vinod mentioned, and, you know, we're learning from Vinod on disasters since last year, our visit to Bhutan, lot of relief systems, everything is primarily coming from the governments today. And so governments are spending on relief on post-disaster things. So enterprise or corporates are not involved, but my guesswork is, or my estimate is that as disasters are growing and their frequency is increasing and their intensity of the damage they cause is going up, at some stage, entrepreneurial ecosystem as well as large corporates will start building solutions for management of disaster, right from the pre-disaster all the way to the end. And that will happen, I think, in the next 3 to 4 years. We're already starting to see people interested in building risk assessment, early warning, as Sumit would say, geotemporal data to manage disasters. So it's a matter of time. I would see this as an opportunity as an entrepreneur, so that, you know, before big people get in, if I build something which is useful, I think, you know, it's useful in all angles, monetarily as well as for the entrepreneurs.
But we'd like to understand this a bit more. The big companies have the means, in the sense that they have the tech know-how, they have the manpower, they have the capacity and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. But they are not doing this kind of stuff. Is it because, you know, agar banaya bhi, to who will buy it? And what is the disaster? It comes in once in 5 years, once in 10 years, I don't know. So the kind of utility of this kind of software, if we try and sell it, or this kind of a system, is not very well defined. And it's notoriously difficult to do business with the government, saying that, look, we have built this system, it costs about 400 crores, will you please buy it now? Right? So would you agree that big business is kind of biased against doing anything about this? Because disasters are like a kind of statistical event. It's not someone is giving you a job, right? It's like it's demanding that you invest your energy and don't get a guaranteed return.
See, there are two parts to it. Big companies, they operate in large markets where the solutions and services or products are understood, and that's where they build their business. There is a part of large companies or even small companies where there is either no market or market is going to come in future. That's an opportunity that you have to grab. Now, that requires research to building the market, to evangelizing the solution, all of this stuff. And it's not that big companies won't do it. If you have entrepreneurial DNA in your system, be it large company or small entrepreneurs, you will put focus on this. But if you don't have the entrepreneurial DNA, obviously you will not put your thought behind it and continue to go after markets that are well known. That, I think, is a way to look at it.
But do large companies have entrepreneurial DNA as far as these things go? Because it seems to make more sense to apply your entrepreneurial DNA to get jobs from abroad, which are much easier.
No. I think there are entrepreneurial DNAs to looking at, the current opportunities, including large companies. So COVID, I think, as Vinod mentioned, is an infopedic, but a lot of people have stepped in to build, solutions, products for different parts of COVID pandemic problem. So, but there, it's so in front of you that people got in and did that. Other disasters, as you mentioned about, let's say, glacial lake or earthquakes or, you know, forest fires or urban floods, these are not that direct, but I think their intensity and their volume or the damage they're causing will make anybody sit up and take notice. Is there something I can do or we can do? And is there a business there? Some of them will say yes, and they'll come in.
Maybe this pandemic has kind of has given a stimulus for people to start thinking about disasters more than they would have in the past as a business.
I would think so. Vinod would be in a better position to answer that question. But my guess is that it has helped people to think about disasters, definitely.
Thanks, Kiran. I'd like to pick on Sumit now, right? Sumit, so okay, fine. Say that we want to make a difference in this space, okay? But how many people are actually acquainted with the tools that can actually help us, right? Which is geospatial tools. How much know-how is there in this area?
Now, this is interesting. I want to make sure you can hear me first.
Yes, we can hear you. Okay. Yes.
So, the geospatial technology and the output of India in geospatial technologies and information services has been consistently more than 50% of geospatial technology workers kind of come from the Indian subcontinent. And we have been providers of data. But sadly, for now, most of these people have been working on projects that are top down. In the last 5 years, we have noticed that geospatial technologies, particularly through participatory GIS and what we call as voluntary geographic information, has led to a kind of revolution which brings information bottom up. And hence, there's a new paradigm even in disaster management where people can use data coming from people and sensors. IoT is also a very important player here. So the entire information systems in disasters have now transformed where a lot of things can be done without spending the billions of dollars or rupees, from the government side. It can be built from very small individual networks of sensors, of people, and hence geospatial information technology itself and the professionals, both of them have changed and they are available in India.
Okay, that's very interesting. Can you just illustrate to us what top-down and bottom-up means? And does ISRO have a role to play in that?
Yeah, so for example, when we spoke about top-down approaches, you have the National Spatial Data Infrastructure, which is formed by a government of India mandate, similar to many other spatial data infrastructures around the world. But these people have been struggling to make sure that data is available, updated. A major challenge for geospatial information is to make the data available at the right time and with a particular accuracy level, which is never sufficient in any disasters that we have encountered till now. I mean, Vinod will vouch for that. Whenever there is a disaster, people say, now we have to make the data available. Now, luckily, due to this citizens approach, participatory GIS and participation of at the ground level, what has happened is information gets available continuously, updated maps like open series maps of the streets of India, different places people live and conditions. It has changed, transformed the availability of information in terms of the applications that are possible on disaster management. And that's the bottom-up approach that I was referring to.
But can the mango people get access to this kind of data? As they say, the aam aadmi.
Yes, mango people can get access as much. And the community's role in providing access for its own members is very important in this context, because nobody is going to worry about you more than you yourself. So the community itself has to provide, and it has been, for example, let's say fisher communities. Fisher communities have been continuously updating their location maps, because they are probably, most vulnerable to coastal disasters. And similarly, farmers have been trying to put their, what crops they have sowed, what is it that they are facing. They have been putting it on. So lot of things are happening right now. And it is truly a stage where people are democratizing geospatial, the democracy in geospatial information is happening kind of in that sense.
Okay, that's very interesting. So now I think you guys have set the scene for where the conversation is going. Okay, so we have some big changes happening. There's a democratization, as you say, happening to access to data and the mode of working and stuff like that. And there's new technology appearing on the horizon. There's a lot of open source information available. Like, I believe that there are some US satellites which give you detailed data, which even the Indians don't, that ISRO also doesn't release, but this is available in open source from US sources related to India, right? Hour-wise spatial data and stuff like that. And there are lots of sources. I'm told that, for instance, certain large companies in India have got more detailed maps of infrastructure and of regions than even the Indian government has. So there's a lot of data which is available out there. So something that we'll try and relate to is what we can do with all this stuff. So this is the potential, right? So we've got the idea from Kiran that corporates have the ability, but there's no immediate business case for working on the very critical and crucial kind of disaster management solutions that we need yesterday. Okay. And plus, the whole disaster management scenario is so wide that you can't expect one or two large companies to address them all. So that's when we come to this thing of what can our youth do? Because we've discovered through eYantra that you should never underestimate a young engineer in this country, right? Don't believe that it's only the IITians who do stuff. eYantra has shown us that 80% of the great minds are out there, and they are capable, and they are willing, and they are doing some really cool stuff if you can just channelize them in the right direction, right? So what I'd like to now discuss with you folks is how can we take this very potent resource out there, which is the young engineers and young minds who are first, second, third, fourth year engineering students, right? And remember, we churn out 1 million students every year. So even if you take 5% of them, that's a very large number, right? We can do some amazing stuff with them, given that there's such dramatic change happening. So I'd like to sort of first, this time now, pick on Kiran, right, to ask him how he suggests, how he feels that we'll be able to turn this resource which exists out there. See, most of our kids are in a kind of rote learning mode, right? Unko muh mein gyan dalo, wo apna exam mein pass karke, they'll do that type of stuff. We need to acquaint them with practical abilities, and then we need to turn that switch inside their mind which makes them feel empowered enough to solve real problems instead of just doing what the teacher asked them to solve, basically, right? So, and the key to it all is thinking entrepreneurially. That means that you stop instead of thinking as a knowledge consumer, books se padho, 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 you have to think in terms of, I am a creator of knowledge potentially. I can solve problems. So I'd like to ask Kiran how we can get the young people to overcome this barrier which is in their mind, stopping them from solving real problems. So over to you, Kiran.
Kavi, I'll sort of give you, these on-the-spot thinking, some broad things that we need to do. Let's say we have 50,000, as you say, 5% of the student. There is a large student population. And see, if you see this group here, we have someone like Vinod who understands disaster, inside out. We don't need to go anywhere else. There's enough data here. We are technologists, and we can put the two together to first identify potentially where the problems and to contours of a solution lies. We have to take it to the student, equip them with the tools to formulate that into prototypes, products, whatever we choose to call it. But it is important, while we are doing it, it should not be seen as a project to get a grade and move on. If that is the approach, then the approach will be different. The approach here is that whatever you do here can turn into a something on which business can be built. So it's very important. I see the role of faculty here from the colleges to make sure that they are involved because they have the maturity as well as the domain knowledge. some of us will have to bring in the body of knowledge that is necessary for product management, you know, how an idea gets commercialized. You know, if it's a new idea, as I mentioned, disaster management is a new area. So anybody who's building something will have to create a very strong narrative to evangelize this to the government and bodies like World Bank or anybody else who are consuming that kind of a district administration, so that an awareness builds and from there you'll have to build. I also see the role of investors. So let's say you talk about 50,000 students, and let's take 0.1% of those students, you know, come out with good ideas, and take another 1% of those students who build, you know, products which are good. You're still dealing with a few hundred companies over here. So it's a combination of students building prototypes, faculty helping, us putting the role of additional faculty where we teach them entrepreneurship, making sure that whatever they are building has a chance to survive. First, as a product or a technology. Second, it scales up using the ecosystem to invest. And we teach these students along with us to go to the market. I just want to end here. Last 3 years, two of my very successful mentee companies, they started their company when they were in second year. One company that has done two rounds of funding, the students are still in the fourth year of computer science. And the other company students started in second year, they've done three rounds of funding. And today they present to us as investors. These are kids who are less than 26 year old. So it is possible to go through this process to build something which typically is like a 15 year old playing international cricket. You're not expecting them to do, but there is one individual we have seen at 16 play at that level, a very hard game. So if you're giving me 50,000 students, I'm very encouraged that we'll find those.
Kiran, one more thing. Yesterday, we were having a chat with the campus ambassadors. We have about 60 campus ambassadors who are taking the message of the eYantra Innovation Challenge to the campuses. He brought up a very pertinent question. Sir, he said, IIT bachchon ko aasani se venture capital mil jata hai. Hamari kaun sunega? In the sense that he feels that tier one and two, tier two colleges are or students from them are far more challenged getting capital or getting noticed or getting any help of this kind from outside. What is your view on that? What's your experience?
If you are a good entrepreneur and you have a good idea, if you're not from IIT, that's not a handicap. And the two cases I mentioned, one student set is from BITS Pilani, and you can say, well, BITS Pilani is a, you know, tier one top college, but the other one is a local, very good local engineering college. So investors can very quickly see that here is a good entrepreneur. It doesn't matter whether you're from IIT or not. If you take 100 entrepreneurs, hopefully you will find some good entrepreneurs from IIT, but that is not, as you yourself said, that there are a lot of great minds outside. So anyone who is not in IIT, I give them message that you have a good idea and you're working well. Investors are not going to say, since you're not from IIT, I'm not writing a check. That won't happen.
No, we want to make it so that if they are from eYantra, you will write the check, basically. So I told them that don't worry about that. You belong to eYantra now, right? And we feel you can do it. And I'm sure you can do it. And that actually gives them heart. And I think, which is very important.
As you know, Kavi, that this year, eYantra, the training program we are putting, innovation and entrepreneurship is a module. And, you know, Lokesh asks me every time, my slides are ready, but I want to do it differently than when I teach professional entrepreneurs. So students are first very agile. And number one, you need to throw many problems at them and they can solve quickly. Even if they come up with a contour of the problem, you can help them to do that. So I think those who come into eYantra this year will have that knowledge, Sumit's knowledge, Vinod's knowledge, what I'm going to put in, and we're going to put on disaster management. I think that's good enough platform to see some entrepreneurs coming from the student side.
Okay, wonderful. Thanks. Vinod, time to unravel you a little bit, right? So we've been working on your presentations on disaster management and all that, right? And what has your experience been working with young people in this space in the past, in conveying the issues?
Yes. See, actually, I think the young people are very creative, very imaginative, and also you know, very, very creative and trying to find solutions. So if you see what is happening in our country today, you know, you also will see that there's a lot of jugaad which is happening, right? How do you really look at the diagnostics of problem solving? You know, and that I think is going to be a challenge for all of us, and young people can look at very creative ways of problem solving. So I think that, you know, they are, you know, they are used to this idea of, you know, trying to look at the unconventional, unorthodox ways of approaching a problem. You know, we tend to be linear sometimes. You know, we look at things, everything in a very structured way. But the young generation, the Gen Next is actually, you know, willing to take risks. Their risk appetite is very high. So I think what Kiran was mentioning also about, you know, young entrepreneurs, startup companies, you know, you can see that there are many startups who have also become unicorns, you know, over a period of time, mainly because of the way that, you know, they look at the ecosystem, they understand the international market, they understand the national market, and they're able to come up with solutions. So in this younger generation, working with the younger people, I think, you know, we will actually learn a lot in this whole process. That's what I think. Because I've been looking at some of your old videos of the earlier eYantra challenges and the robotics challenges which you've been having. And I think that, you know, there is a lot of confidence in these young people to take risks and come up with solutions.
So that's very useful to know. In fact, perhaps you can acquaint them with the kind of gyan that they should be prepared to receive in the training phase of the competition, right? As to what can they expect? What can they anticipate?
I think there will be lots of surprises. You know, we will also be learning a lot from them because, you know, like the discussion which we had yesterday about the film, which is actually being shown. So we will actually be seeing many, many such situations where, you know, there'll be lots of surprises. And it's a co-creation of opportunities. You know, we would need to really look at every problem. And like right now, we see the COVID experience and we see a lot of young doctors, you know, young IT engineers, you know, from the computer science or from electronics, from communication, from signaling, you know, they're able to come up with a lot of solutions in trying to look at the travel of migrant workers, for instance. You know, they're able to find livelihood opportunities, diversification. So I think that, you know, young people will approach the problem without hesitation. You know, we hesitate when we are posed with a problem, but then younger people are willing to take challenges and then, you know, willing to take risks. I think, you know, this is a very good opportunity for us.
This is a very important point that you made, Vinod, that young people don't have legacy. They're not tied in old ways of thinking. They can look at problems in totally new ways. Kiran, is there something that you wanted to say?
I want to say one thing. You know, people these days say age is just a number. I have seen, excuse me, if you take 1,000 young people, you know, under 25, you will see a lot of them not having legacy and ready to experiment. But do not forget people advanced age 30, 40, 50, 60, who have tremendous appetite for risk, have a childlike enthusiasm, very healthy, and they are ready to take risk. And Professor Vinod Menon is one of them. I am one of them. You know, you have built everything. So this is not to say that young does not only mean age. Young also means young at everything. And in fact, last year in our Tai Pune mentoring program, we found not 20-something, but experienced entrepreneurs because they had that experience. So if you can combine the wisdom, experience with the risk-taking, then you have the best of the both worlds. So I think somehow we get caught that, like, I'm 65 right now, and come and jog with me. I'll probably beat most of them. I come in the top 20% when I jog. So, you know, I compete with everybody. You know, I compete with everyone. So it all depends on who you are, what you are. But I think the good thing for students here is that the program we are putting together will have the entrepreneurial genes, the ability to try, you know, articulate disaster management where the real opportunity will be in front of them. After that is for them to run. I also see many, Kavi, you mentioned, and just take 1 minute, that sure. as a student, you're in the absorption mode. And I think as a good student, you must absorb. And it's not just the degree course, but throughout life, you must absorb. But you must try and experiment and apply it. And, you know, entrepreneurship is something as a, you know, it's also a something that you learn along the way. So I'm not saying that every 50,000 person students who probably you may have access to becomes an entrepreneur. That won't happen. It's like I'm a lousy singer. I will never be a good singer. So if you're creating singers, count me out. So some people may not do that, but they may still work with new companies. They may have, some people will crank it, some people will build it, some people will invest it. As long as the ecosystem comes together, that's fine. So to share with you, the person who provides drinks in a test match is as important as the batsman who's playing, because without that drink, you know, there'll be no century out there. So let's put everybody together here, young, that's old, wonderful. Everyone, so that we move forward. Then.
Kiran, one thing I'd like to just reflect upon here, this came out in our trip to Bhutan. So, you know, I've stopped believing in coincidences. Okay, Kiran, right? We are all here for a purpose. And it's not a coincidence. And we are all young people. In fact, I'm very proud to say that I was given a certificate. The 133 interns who came and spent 6 weeks online with us in a remote internship this year have put together a beautiful yearbook, of which I'll send you a copy. Your talk is also mentioned in that. And right at the end, they've written a thanks to me and says, and under my photo, they put the youngest member of the family. And to me, that is a certificate worth aspiring to, right? So I think age is just a number. It's the kind of energy and curiosity and playfulness that you bring. And playfulness actually solves problems more than anything else, you know. And Sumit, I was going to come to you, right? Before you say what you wanted to say, or maybe you say it, and then I'd like you to answer the question as to a little idea, a teaser for what gyan you are going to bato in your part of the training.
I like your English, Kavi. No, bato should be in Oxford Dictionary.
I just want to take it up from Vinod's mention of, you know, legacy and, you know, younger generation not being bound to legacy. Something that is very very difficult with geospatial information or GIS as we know it has been a very let's say legacy bound and, you know, done in research institute. Even in the computer science department, you have the GIC or GIS people as something they do something separate. Now what has happened in the last decade or so, I would say, is the emergence of the open source, the mainstreaming of the entire software ecosystem with geospatial technologies, the mainstreaming. So there are three points that I wanted to make. One is the open source in data, in systems, in tools that you use. The second thing is the geospatial technology, big data kind of analytics that has come in, and it has come in a very big way. And the people who have been using this even can't fathom how, you know, the innovation part of it is still out there. People are trying out. And there is a lot of multidisciplinary aspect of geospatial technologies, which is very common to disaster management as well. And this is the aspect of innovation, you know, multidisciplinary focus that comes together, and which is something that I will focus in my teaching, where people will understand how demographics, how human geography and physical geography, how you know, hydrology related things come together with, say, mobile communication. So that's where a lot of innovation is required, and I'm hoping that the spatial thinking, which is something that we in the subcontinent lack, in the way that we had not used maps for until Google Maps came into India at a broad scale. So the spatial thinking that can usher in a new era of geospatial technology will happen. And I have a good reason to believe that, you know, this will happen beyond government control. This will happen with people having the technology. I'll just share one example. when Google Maps happened, all governments across the countries, they said, this is way too much. You can't open up maps to everybody. These are, you know, at that resolution, at that level. But the technology pushed change. And we are hoping that geospatial, the new breed of geospatial technology and disaster management informatics will change how disaster is happened, disaster has been managed across the world, especially in India.
So this is excellent. Yeah. Excellent to know. Kavi, so this is a flavor for what we'll be getting. Yes, Vinod.
Yeah, Kavi, actually, you know, the fact that, you know, we have people like Kiran who believe that, you know, you have to be domain agnostic, you know, and if you're domain agnostic, you can look at an IT person can come up with a solution for, you know, disaster management in very creative ways. And then, you know, you look at technology like, you know, communication or, you know, AI algorithms or robotics actually trying to find solutions. And then you have the big data, you know, socioeconomic and demographic data, and how we will be able to really look at the creative ways of addressing the data gaps. You know, critical data gaps. Like right now, we find that, you know, we say that, you know, we do not have the data of how many migrant workers were actually traveling or how many doctors are actually, you know, dying because of the COVID. You know, but we need to really look at opportunities to give a problem to the young minds and also the elderly people, you know, who also provide the solutions, because, you know, we have a lot of dreamers here, you know, people who have ideas, people who have visioning, people who are able to be thought leaders and provide solutions. So I think we can really look forward to that, Kavi.
This is very important, I think, that you said that. I'm going to give the last word to Kiran in a moment. But, you know, what you said is very important. This comes out of our desire, because the thing is that we have come together because we have full confidence in the community of young people that eYantra is addressing at the moment. We have the confidence that you guys in your first, second, third, fourth year, whatever it is, can solve real problems. And eYantra has proven that year after year. This year, we are going to channel you to actually solve real problems. And you don't have to become an entrepreneur and start a company and all that, right? You can, the entrepreneurial spirit is a state of mind. Any company would also love to have these people in them, because they can be intrapreneurs, entrepreneurs within a company. An entrepreneur is someone who doesn't need to be told, do this, do that, do this, do that. You know, an entrepreneur is someone who decides that, sir, I think this is the problem that needs to be solved. Let's solve it. And I think this is the way to do it. I would much rather have employees like that rather than saying, saab, abhi kaam do mujhe, you know. Right.
Kavi, you said last time that there were even students on the ITIs and polytechnics.
Absolutely. Who've done beautifully. Who've done very, very well. So eYantra gives a very democratic platform to students, right, with modest means, from high colleges, from low colleges, from polytechnics, from what have you, to come together to do something cool. And the other important reason why the students are important is that you are the entrepreneurs who are embedded inside the opportunity. Now, the kind of opportunities you will see around you in Jharsuguda or some other town or village somewhere in India, remote India, you might see problems that nobody else can see. Sitting in Bombay, sitting in Delhi, sitting in Bangalore, we can't see those problems. But those problems might be very important problems, which if you solve, can transform India. It can be applied to all the tier 2 towns in India. Right? So don't underestimate the value of your idea, number one. Lastly, is that, you know, we are trained by our families to just take up a job and, are kya entrepreneur banoge tum, and this and that. So one last question I'd like to leave with Kiran is that, sir, I don't have Gupta, Agarwal, Jain, or all these things as my surname. How can I be an entrepreneur, sir?
Good question. Interesting, Kavi. My elder son, Shantanu, who's an entrepreneur in his own right, both of us are entrepreneurs, but very different. He's visiting Pune. He runs a company called Bombay Shaving. And so think about Deshpande's doing this kind of thing, not Gupta's and Agarwal's. I think the good thing about India is that communities build some capabilities. So when you mentioned Gupta and Agarwal, you are talking about an amazing entrepreneurial acumen.
Yes.
Now that acumen built because of the community, some leaders in that community pick that up and pass from generation to generation. Now, today in the network world, there is no reason for a Arya or an Upadhyay or a Hussein or anybody else to pick that information and become an entrepreneur. And so that kind of a unification will happen. I would also say that, you know, today country has more prosperity. We have a lot of problems. So we have definite prosperity. And you talk to young people, and that I actually mean then the young age. They always will tell you that, you know, when we were growing up, getting meals wasn't important. Having a house, having ability to buy your meals and all that was important. And so we went into jobs. But today, sometimes students can do backpacking. You know, there is enough parentage or there is enough ecosystem from where you can do some experimentation. So I think that will give us entrepreneurship. I think the country is also, there is a little big glitch because of the pandemic in the GDP, but per capita, it gets to a point where India is fast reaching there in the next 3 years, where the consumption will take off from that point. And when the consumption takes off from there, the whole economy builds up. And we are very entrepreneurial as a nation. And Vinod used the word jugaad. Personally, I don't like the word jugaad. Indians are forced to do jugaad because of the stifling environment around us. But you take that off, now we have a large number of creative people, be it a Gupta, be it a Ranade, be it a Subramanyam. I'm just using it in a very positive sense because this is a big country of different communities, and that's amazing that we have. That will happen. Specific to disaster, Kavi, I want to just leave this thought. It's a global problem. Whether it's a flash flood, quick flood in south of Pune because of some dams have been opened up, or a sudden fire halfway around the world, there is a commonality to these disasters, which is what we learned from Vinod. And that's where I got to thinking, if there is a commonality, can I as a technologist build a platform which can be applied to multiple disasters? The second thing I learned from Vinod, and all of us know that India has amazing ability as a domain knowledge in disaster, and that other countries can use it. The third one is we are very good in software. If you pull the three together, there's no reason why the next generation disaster technologies or solutions or platforms can come from here. And we're not talking about like 6 months. I must tell students, don't read this newspaper where somebody says, you know, you started a company in 2 years, it become. Nothing happens that fast. Nothing happens that fast. You are in it for a long haul. And if you can put some 5, 6, 7 years, I think you will see some results coming out, which you will be happy that you did. Entrepreneurship is how I would put it. It's a global problem. Something you build in Powai might be applicable in Honduras, and maybe Vinod might be the channel for that because he knows where the disasters happen and what their nature is.
So Kiran, thanks for that. You broad-based this conversation. You are essentially saying what I keep saying to my students, that, you know, until 200 years ago, India was 26% of global GDP. We were the creative nation and capital of the world in textiles, metallurgy, handicrafts, you name it. And we were boss in those days, right? And the other 26% was in China. And we used to only accept payment in gold, which is why the gold reserves are pretty high in this country. And we were disliked for that. Yeah. It's only that colonization in the last 200 years has changed our self-perception. And I think what needs to be done is to re-change this self-perception to an attitude of abundance, because we've come into an attitude of scarcity, which is there in most of our older generation, which is afraid to take risks. Yeah. Right? But this is the time to take risks, because jobs are disappearing. Nobody is going to give you a job in your mouth now. You have to go out there and find jobs. You have to have a different attitude. Yeah. And I think this whole Yantra activity and innovation challenge is about changing our attitude to life so we can create jobs, find jobs, discover jobs. And disaster management is one place to start. So this is one nice focused area in which we have the privilege of having some very talented young people. We have Kiran here. We have Professor Menon. We have Sumit. We have Raghunath Iyer, who's a very fine electronics industry professional who can teach you how to build the products, world-beating products. And we have a new addition, Akshay Mishra, who's a communications expert, IIT Bombay alumnus, who will tell you, right, how to make really cool communication devices which you never thought of before, right, and what to do with them. So we have a really dream team here, and then we have the eYantra team, and we have and our Uday. Interns
and Uday.
And Uday, Uday. Yes.
Uday and Vinny, yes, who understands the insurance part of it.
So we have Uday Ramtirthkar, who is ex TCS, and he's a great guy in modeling and software engineering and stuff like that. We have Vineet Patni, who's helping us, who's a guru in the insurance space. And incidentally, insurance companies are the first stop for marketing any of these disaster management products, because disasters is their bread and butter. They want to know, right, what disasters, when, how much expenditure, this, that, and the other is going to help their business. So I think that we have a very nice making of an amazing journey in innovation this year with the kind of team that we've assembled. We have the eYantra team.
Your eYantra team.
Yes. Absolutely. The eYantra team. I'd like to thank the eYantra team, which has made this program possible. This is all due to their hard work. We have Suprabha, we have Deepa here, we have Aditya Agarwal, who incidentally is our intern. But I mean, we treat him as part of the eYantra team. Likewise, we have 133 interns who interned with us this year. They've become an intimate part of the family. So we are a growing kind of community out there. And we are really looking forward to what promises to be a very exciting journey. And I would like you all to join us. Just register. Registrations have opened yesterday. And kind of you're in for a real heck of a ride this year if you're interested. And so disaster management is one aspect. What you learn in the process of this training will be Atmanirbharta. It will be how to become, it will empower you. It will change your perspective on life. And that's why we are spending our time, because we feel that the young people in this country need that kind of, you know, change in perspective. So welcome on board, everyone. I'd like to really thank our panelists here today, Kiran Deshpande, Vinod Menon, Sumit Sen, and our team in the back. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.